Forum 2019. Thank you for taking the time to be with us today. At De Beers, safety is our priority. If you hear an alarm at any time during the next 3 days, please note that it is not a drill. There are 3 exit doors illuminated in green. During an emergency, kindly follow these signages till you reach the external entry of the convention center located behind you. The goal of our forum is to provide a wide platform for all our partners to interact, transact, and gain a new perspective on Forevermark's growth in the context to events within and outside the industry. Through the next 3 days, we hope you enjoy discussions on diversity in thought, culture, design, and innovation in a multifaceted future brimming with diverse opportunities. To get started, I'd like to invite Mr. Sachin Jain, President Forevermark India, to take the stage.
Wow. Distinguished guests, friends, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pride that I welcome each and every member of this NMN gathering to the 8th annual Forevermark Forum in this charming, lovely city of Bangalore. You know, this city is special to us because this is where it all started for us way back in 2011. I'm gratified to see our esteemed partners in the audience, and I thank you all for gracing this occasion. We all at De Beers highly value your commitment, and your presence means a lot to us. And whilst you pledge your time to be here, I urge you all to absorb as much from this knowledge share platform. Your continued presence also validates the fact that the Forevermark Forum is a unique platform for key industry stakeholders to disseminate information, exchange ideas, and highlights the faith in the power of dialogue and the strength we have as a community. I'm certain this time together will be thoroughly stimulating, enriching, and fun-filled. This year, we have over 550 participants representing 250 organizations from all over the world. Please join me in welcoming our growing partners from pretty much every part of India, our esteemed partners from Middle East, our partners from Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan. I also extend this courtesy to our senior colleagues and management team who've come from United Kingdom, China, Italy, Botswana, and Singapore. A special welcome to Ms. Meeta Rajiv Lochan. Thank you, ma'am, for gracing the occasion. She's the additional director of the General of the Foreign Trade. And a special another thanks to Tarun. Tarun is an ace designer, but also what I like about Tarun is that he's not just got pride for his name and his business, he's got pride for us as a country. Thank you, Tarun, for being here. It's important for us to remind ourselves what business we do and what do we really sell. And I'll start by asking you a question. What do you sell? You know, is it G to H color? Is it V to VVS to SI clarity? Four grainers, fancy shapes, fancy sizes? For some of you, the answer might be all of the above. But I urge, in a very important sense, the answer should be none of the above. Because in the diamond business, we don't sell crystallized carbon. We sell love, we sell meaning, and we sell emotion. And what we sell has an inherent value to our consumers' lives. We all, as diamond people, you know, are really lucky to represent these miraculous gifts from Mother Nature. I urge all of you to feel special of what you enable. You know, you enable that smile. You enable that heart-touching feeling. And through you, right now at your store, someone is experiencing the most memorable occasion of their lifetime. This period ahead of us is the biggest opportunity we have as India, as Indians, and as leaders. And fittingly, the theme of this year's forum is Be Limitless. What do these two words mean? And what do these two words hold within themselves? You know, I don't know whether the first technology created by human was a spear, a hammer, or a tent. But what I do know is that someone had to make a mental leap of imagining each of them, persisting and failing before they could become a reality. We need to be brave enough to believe in a possibility of a slightly different world and go beyond the horizons to captivate this limitless world. And whilst we can't guarantee that everything new you try will succeed, the optimism is vital to putting this pioneering spirit to practical use. It is this default position of leaders like you which make you limitless, and because it enables them to stake a faith in the future, a future that you want to make happen. Leading an organization of any kind, let it be a company, a team, a family, it's hard. It's about a constant sacrifice of sleep, leisure, money, and inevitably, creating anything good, actually, you know, anything that we create, not just organization, anything good, entails awareness of the world around us. If you have the right offering at the right time, the benefits and rewards can be immense. And if you get it right, which I'm sure all of you have, I urge you all to keep getting it right in new ways and changing times. And my friends, our customers will continue to reward us. It is so important that we reflect the phase of life we are in, and most important phase of India. We have recently seen the historic comeback of the government. We surprised actually pretty much everybody, but really three sets of people. It surprised the analysts who were predicting an upside of 240. It surprised the Congress, and it surprised the BJP itself. But whilst there is a thunderous comeback, Modi 2.0 has come back with hope, nationalism, and an inclusive policy. What does this mean to our country? The World Bank has stated that the world image of India is stronger than ever. And fundamentally, the government has the support of its people. We need to believe in our hearts and our minds that we all sitting here are a part of the wave and have a role to play. The Davos Report, United Nations, World Economic Summit, all have predicted that India is moving towards becoming a 5 trillion economy by 2025. Now, that's not something very small, it's something very serious. We're today at 2.7 trillion economy, and I think it's truly our time. The penetration of diamonds in India is about 11% amongst the elite group. Compare this to the other big markets that we have of China, Japan, and the United States, which is of north of 70%. And if we were to bet on the middle class growing consumption and get to a point of a fraction of this number, the opportunity ahead of us is really immense. And my friends, this is coming. United States is the largest diamond consuming market in the world. At about $43 billion, 80% of that is converted by 20% retailers. And this growth in the Indian market will see a similar phase. I want to give a lot of importance of the leaders sitting in this room. You all represent the same 80% of the share today, and I believe that this growth will not be equally spread out. It will be centered to true remitless leaders that you all are. Important is that we need to believe in our hearts and our minds that we will. We at De Beers are very positive of the India growth phase and believe that the business will multiply twice in the coming 5 years. The challenge is that a whole of us will seize this opportunity, whereas a lot of us will see this time pass away in front of our eyes. This is our time to be limitless, my friends, and our time to lead our organizations as limitless leaders. There are some very important and interesting trends that we are noticing. I'd like to share some of them with you. There is a sort of fluidity and frictionless that we see within consumers and workforces. You know, human-computer interactions are becoming seamless, and so must transactions. Amazon Go stores have no checkout lines. Consumers put their stuff in the baskets and just simply walk out. Enablers like WeWork have virtually carved out a new whole industry. The related angle is our workforces. In the United States, over 50% of the workforces are working part-time or consultants or freelancers. We as leaders have to become increasingly open about this way of workforce. Younger workforces like more frictionless environments, more fluidity, more openness. We have to work together to make our industry the first to go magic industry where young minds earn to build their careers with us. The second trend we've been witnessing is the whole emergence of automated financial economy and almost a real-time decision-making. There are over 30 billion IoT devices in the globe. Facebook sees over 1 million updates every minute. Self-driving cars make decisions on a continuous basis, and all of this is becoming a reality. What does this imply in our business? In order to generate optimal results, business leaders must be able to make split-second decisions and not, you know, on the comfort of their boardrooms every time. To give you an example, in a short span of time in the world of driverless cars, if you have to drive from here to MG Road and you're on your driverless cars and you find a jam on the way, your car will negotiate in real time with the car ahead of you, pay them a bit of money so you can get to your destination 20 minutes earlier, and the other cars will reach there 20 minutes later, but they would have made a bit of money. Uber has made the possibility of surge pricing real-time factors of what's the weather, have you walked out of a pop concert, determines the price elasticity. So the pricing for you and me at Uber could be completely different based on your preferences and my preferences. Predictive analysis, which is based on artificial intelligence, is becoming a reality. And in our business, what are the key takeaways from this? The acceptance of usage of technology and trying the things that today we might not be completely convinced is required. We as limitless leaders have to erase this notion from our minds that what's worked in the past is the only way it's going to work in the future. The need of the hour is to think fresh, try new methods, make small steps, small changes, but bring freshness. The third is we're seeing is this whole evolving role of a retailer. Curation is emerging as a main theme. Helping the consumer and not confusing them is important. All research is showing that less is more, and actually more less is more more. The consumer expects the retailer to know her preferences, her purchase history, and make recommendations and solutions accordingly. Data is going to be the king, and the application of data is what is going to happen in the next phase. The earlier behavior that all we used to have about, you know, showing designs after designs, trays after trays to a consumer, all of that we believe will become a history. Also, looking at our business a little more scientifically is important. Understanding the return of capital employed, returns per square foot, seeing what is happening with the slow movers, how the physical movement of consumers is happening in a store, all of that will become a way of life. Fundamentally, what I'm saying is that we all need to move from being just great jewelers to become great retailers, because that's where it's going to be. Our competition of mind space, and hence the wallet share, my friends, is not with the next door competition retailer. It is actually with retail as an industry. And, you know, we have to bring this ease. We have to bring, you know, solutions to the consumer. We have to anticipate the needs of the consumer much before the consumer needs it. And I want to take this commitment from all of you leaders sitting in this room that in the next phase of change, we will drive this change and not be mere followers. And that leads me to my last point on sustainability and environment. And, you know, any discussion on the future is completely futile if we don't talk about what's happening with our environment and what's happening on sustainability. Last year, we talked about gender equality at workforces, and I'm very happy to see the ratio of women in the room today. It's a great start for us, but a long way to go. We celebrate diamonds that do good, and it's important to reflect on what are the wider areas, which is environment, health, safety, community, energy, conservation, variety of things there. Status quo is the only thing that's not an option. We all have to look at the future, accept responsibility, and make an impact. Consumers growingly are getting inclined to consume brands which make a positive impact on the environment and society. Our industry does some phenomenal work in this area. The need of the hour is that we do it diligently and we get better at our storytelling. At De Beers, we are embracing the future and working on all these areas and getting ready for the upcoming opportunity. Certain projects that we are taking are, you know, we're looking at blockchain in a very important manner. We're looking at carbon absorption, omni-channel, automation of a rough processes, rough sorting process so that the pipeline can become shorter. We're taking up marine mining projects, lots of innovations on the new retail formats. There is a growing discussion, and it's important that we talk about it. There's a whole growing discussion about lab-grown diamonds that's in the market. And it's important that we assess what the impact it will hold. There are really two key points in this whole discussion, you know. The first is the illegitimate size, and that's the mixing that's happening. And detection technology is the answer to it. A few years ago, you might have said, I got cheated. But today, if that's a scene and you're saying that I got cheated, you're choosing to do so. Because today, technology is available to give you 100% guarantee of what they are and what they're not. The other area of this is about the whole legitimate size of lab-grown diamonds. But we need to understand that they are not the same business. They are not rare, they don't and never will hold value, and it's truly a different line of business. And they shouldn't be mixed under the same umbrellas of what we offer as brands. And in particularly the case of India, where consumers come to your stores and brands as a value of trust, as a storehouse of wealth, and that's at that time it's quite risky to do something like this. We have amongst us Mr. Stephen Lucia, who reflect upon the depth of what this means to us as De Beers, and what are we doing in the future to make it up. Heera hai sada ke liye, a diamond is forever, is not just a tagline for us at De Beers. It holds a fundamental truth that diamonds have been around forever and ever. And this timelessness represents long-term relationships. And ironically, in this whole era where there's disruption and technology and changes happening, the desire to express genuine love is higher than ever. And we believe that the fundamental growth of diamonds is here to stay. A lot of elements will change around it, and all of us will have to collectively envision a future that's different. Going back in time, when we conceptualized Forever Mark, we knew the issues of consumer confidence. We knew synthetics will become a large play. We knew consumers will be more interested in provenance and where the diamonds are coming from. And not just diamonds, but brands and stronger collaborations will be the answer to deal with the new reality. Forever Mark, my friends, is the catalyst to your business growth. And really, in a true sense, for us at De Beers, has been the arena to get limitless. Our only objective is to grow the diamond business in this new reality. I'd like to show you a video which encapsulates all that we've achieved in the last action-packed year. Can I please have the video?
truly exceptional. And the line that we say, Tamils have been around forever, and we say, Hira hai sada ke liye. The reality is that it has been forever and ever.
Is an extraordinary story. Only 10 years old in the world of luxury brands, you know, that's like a baby. But yet already the world's most important diamond
it
brand.
Is.
Big round of applause to all that we achieved together in the last 1 year. Mr. Stephen Lussier is our leader. He's the chairman of ForeverMark. A lot of you are familiar with him, and he's been the person who's led ForeverMark to become one of the most important phenomena in the global diamond business. Stephen is chairman of the Diamond Producers Association. He's also on the executive committee of De Beers Group. He's now leading a very interesting project that's building forever and that's creating some real impact on natural diamonds. And it is my pleasure to invite Stephen on stage. Please join me in giving a big round of applause to Mr. Stephen Lussier. Thank you, Stephen.
Wow, the room's filled up since I sat down. Welcome, everybody. Also, thank you, Sachin. I think that Sachin has been an extraordinary leader for me here in India, building the ForeverMark brand from, as we say, literally zero, where we started. And for those of you who don't know, we've opened a new De Beers Group office as well in Mumbai, where all parts of the De Beers Group are together, which we're thrilled, and Sachin is looking after that office for us. So congratulations as well, Sachin, on your expanded role for the De Beers Group, which we are indebted to your passion and your commitment to diamonds and to India. I love the theme of Be Limitless. I think it's a great theme because it's what I feel when I look at the ForeverMark and I look into the opportunities here in India. You know, each year I set for Sachin an objective of saying, okay, we want 20% growth. Sachin laughs at me and says, no, I'm going for 100. And I think, well, actually, why not? It's there for us to make what we make of it. And when I was thinking about the theme of Be Limitless, it made me think back to where we all started. You know, it's for some particular reason, it's a pleasure for me to be here in Bangalore, not just because the weather's a lot better than Mumbai. It all started for us here in Bangalore. Sachin and I came prior to the launch in 2011. Our first partners, Abram and CKC, were here in Bangalore, and without a start, where do you go? Nowhere. So I'm really appreciative for our early support in Bangalore. To think that in just 7 years, we've gone from, well, in effect, two stores to some 240, you know, nearly 150,000 diamonds inscribed for India. It's an extraordinary story. In volume terms, that growth over recent years has taken India for us in the Forevermark world to number two country in the world. We sell more Forevermark diamonds here in India than we do in the U.S. Yeah. Applause for you in the room who make it happen. But actually, I'm getting a little of that Sachin passion. And, you know, why number two? Why not number one? Why can't we collectively make India number one in the world for the place where we sell more Forevermark diamonds? I think that that's a burning ambition, and it's a burning ambition we should grasp at this forum and work out how do we make that not just an ambition or an aspiration, but a reality, because it's within our grasp to do, and we need to do it. Sachin and the team over the next couple of days, I'm sure, will show you all the things that we can do collectively to make that possible, but if we grasp it, it is an aspiration, an ambition within our grasp. And partly it made me think, well, why am I so confident about that? And I think it's useful sometimes just to take a step back and think about Forevermark and what it means and why I think it is absolutely the right thing at the right time. And it's important in life, if you have a really good idea, that actually it is of its time. I've seen some good ideas that were too early and others that are too late and they don't work as well. But I think it is of its time now, not only in the world, but here in India. And let me reflect a little bit on why. And first, I just need to talk to you a little bit about the world of luxury goods and how I see it evolving globally. I think we have to all understand that we are living in an increasingly branded world. It's simply a fact. If I look first in the luxury goods world, there's no doubt that the big global luxury goods brands have driven desire and demand for their product over the last decade in a way which we have to admit has outpaced what we've achieved in the jewelry industry. Their growth rates have been stronger than ours. We've been growing, but not like they have. And we must look at some of the reasons why. And I think at the center of it is the power of these brands, of these global brands, in what is increasingly, particularly for younger consumers, an increasingly global world. And the thing that's making that happen is social media. It's an extraordinarily powerful thing for brands that have a global footprint. I'm going to tell you, for those of you who were here a couple of years ago, I talked about my son Sam, the high jumper. You might remember young Sam clearing the hurdle with his Fosbury flop, a demonstration of innovative techniques. But I've got three boys, so I want to tell you a story about my oldest son, Jake. Jake came to me a couple of months ago, and he said, and you have to listen really carefully to young people to understand really the insight. He said to me, Dad, I want to buy a Supreme jacket. Now, those of you who don't know, which included me, Supreme is a very fashionable young sort of surfer brand in the world that the millennials know intuitively and people like me learn about when my kids tell me. But my answer was typical of my generation, which was to say, you don't need a jacket. And I misunderstood entirely the point. He doesn't need a jacket. He wants a Supreme jacket. He actually wants a Supreme, the brand. He doesn't need the jacket. He doesn't really want the jacket. He wants what the brand meant. And I said to him, well, how did this, you know, why do you want this? He said, well, I was looking at my social media and they got this really cool new thing. And so that's the other insight. His desire for the product was created by him following, not jackets. He doesn't follow jackets on Instagram. He follows Supreme. And they created desire for him to buy something that he didn't need and didn't know he needed because he follows them. And that's why this power of social media to make brands so powerful as creators of desire is a reality that we now need to appreciate in the environment where social media becomes the dominant marketing force for a generation of consumers. And they don't just look at local brands, huh? They search the global world. Supreme is not a British brand where my son lives, but he follows it. And he knows about it. And he'll tell you the story of the founder of Supreme and what his aspirations in life are. He knows this so much more, which branded social media drives. That's one of the reasons why we're seeing this branded world grow. The good news for us is that diamonds, long unbranded, are catching up. The data we're seeing today from places like America and China show us that the majority of diamond engagement rings sold today in those countries are considered by those consumers to be branded. A decade ago in America, the figure was way south of 10%. So it's accelerating fast. That's a good thing for us. Because if we don't harness the power of brand, we're going to lose these young consumers to other product categories. Brands give, we all know, margin. And gosh, we know we need that. Huh? We need margin and profitability in our business. They give us marketing muscle, particularly global brands, because we can harness the power of marketing across multiple countries, particularly in the social media world. They allow us to use that technology of today in the digital world in a way it's very difficult for an individual jeweler to do. But the brands, Forevermark, can help him to do that. And I guess, you know, lastly, we just recognize they're in a global world now with these consumers. Whether we like it or not, they're living in a global world. And the brand have the ability to be in that global world while translating it back to a local opportunity. That's why I think we need to harness, for our industry, the power of brands. The second thing I've seen, which again is, I think, really interesting for the jewelry industry and for Forevermark in particular, is we've seen a change in the luxury goods world about what they consider to be the pillars of their industry, the foundation upon which they build their brands. If we went back a decade, they would say there are three key words that drive luxury brands: exclusivity, quality, and status, symbol of financial wealth. And they define themselves around that. I mean, I always thought exclusivity was the most interesting because it's defining yourself by what customers you don't want and what customers you do have. And I can remember so well as a young man going into a Cartier store. Hope there's no Cartier people here today. It was a long time ago. And when I went in, I felt like the salesperson thought that they were better than me. You know, it was the arrogance they felt. And they actually were trying to project that. They were trying to say Cartier is only for some of us, because that was exclusivity. But those days, my friend, exclusivity, just quality, and just financial status, they are going. And they're being replaced by three other characteristics. Inclusivity. I'll talk a little bit about these as they relate to Forevermark. Inclusivity, which means no more arrogance. If a customer loves our product, whoever they are, we love them. We're not judgmental. We love people who love what we do. Secondly, is about craftsmanship. Now, that's similar to quality, but it's not the same. And this is what consumers are looking for. If you talk about quality, I can bang quality out on a machine over and over. Craftsmanship is about where's the magic of the hands? Huh? Where's the expertise that creates something which is perceived by the consumer to be unique? That's the difference between craftsmanship and quality. And this is a great opportunity for the jewelry industry relative to other luxury goods. And the third is that the old financial wealth status is being replaced with some other aspiration. And that aspiration is called social purpose. I don't aspire to the product because it makes me look wealthy. I aspire to that product because by owning and wearing it, it makes me look like I'm a good human contributing to the world. Social purpose. And being defined, we see this already in the Western market. If you're just defined by wealth, people look at you, a product defined by wealth, people look at you a little bit like, well, you know, is that really right? But if you're defined by something which is making a positive contribution into the world, that becomes something I want to be part of and respected for. It's a subtle change. So remember these three words: inclusivity, craftsmanship, social purpose. And when I think about Forever Mark, I think, wow, we're there, huh? Maybe by design, maybe by a little bit of luck, hopefully more foresight than luck, but for whatever reason, that's where our brand is. Inclusivity. Our brand from the beginning, Forever Mark, was designed as a brand which would be available and open to all as long as they believed in the idea of the most beautiful diamond that they could afford. It wasn't only for the super wealthy. It is for the super wealthy, but not only. Anybody who believes in the pursuit of beauty and uniqueness, we have a Forever Mark and we welcome them to us. And you can see that in our marketing materials. There's nothing arrogant about a Forever Mark communication. It's open, it's transparent, it's welcoming. That's part of the new luxury. Second is craftsmanship. And I can go on a long time about craftsmanship because there's so much of it in our Forever Mark world. It clearly starts with a selection by people, experts, with eyes and experience of the diamonds which are more beautiful than other diamonds of similar 4C characteristics. It has to start with the inherent beauty. Not about paper, as Sachin said. It's about beauty of the diamond, because that's what matters to people when they wear the diamonds and people see them sparkling fantastically. It's about that beauty. That requires skill and experience. And of course, they then need to be cut and polished by masters, huh? That's hand craftsmanship. And then the jewelry designs. You know, again, we don't bang those out one after the other. They're crafted. They're unique. Packaging all that together, all of that uniqueness and craftsmanship is precisely what consumers tell us they're looking for as they look for luxury in the future. They don't want the same as everybody else. They want to feel experts involved. And the third, of course, is social purpose. And this has been at the heart of Forever Mark from the day we designed it as a differentiator from other luxury goods. You know, we have the line responsibly sourced. And to me, and I've challenged my friend Costa sitting right in the front to get a better line. Responsibly sourced seems to me like yesterday. It's like the minimum. Of course it's responsibly sourced. But that's not social purpose. And De Beers and Forever Mark stand for much more. For me, social purpose is making a positive, proactive contribution to the world through the business of bringing our product from the ground to the consumer through the brand Forever Mark. And you know, there are two core areas that we stand for: helping women and girls, particularly for De Beers in the producer countries where that's so important. You can see my He for She badge. You can see the big He for She area in the back. Please go learn about it. Helping, you know, how I say, in the end, the famous slogan, diamonds are a girl's best friend. Let's make sure that just doesn't mean the consumer. Let's make sure, as a result of diamonds coming from the ground all the way to them, that women benefit. I think it makes sense for our industry, and it's something that we can make a difference about. And secondly, the natural world. And I get very passionate about the natural world. If for those of you who have had the opportunity to visit a place like Botswana, where diamonds are so important to the country, what is the other thing that's important to that country in sustaining their economies in the decades to come beyond diamonds? It is ecotourism. What does ecotourism require? Requires some animals. Huh? You know, you need to have an environment where elephant and rhino can prosper, because it's the foundation of their economic development. And fortunately, diamond mines are pretty good places for that, because when we operate a diamond mine, there's a lot of land which we own beyond the mine itself. At De Beers, we actually have 6 hectares of land for every hectare that is in the mining, actual mining area. And in those 6 hectares, we can do the conservation work in a way that we think contributes powerfully to those nations, be it rhino breeding, be it moving giants. You must learn a little bit about this fantastic program where we're moving elephant, where we have too many in Venetia Mine in South Africa, to Mozambique, where they have too few in their national park. It's a fantastic initiative, but this is all about social purpose. We do it because it's right, but consumers are attracted to this going forward. Young consumers want to be associated with things that they can be proud of, and you can all be proud of what the Forevermark diamonds are doing in the area of social purpose. And this is why I think Forevermark around the world is growing so strongly in what I know is a difficult economic environment. It's not an easy time for diamond jewelry around the world. Not a bad time, but it's not a boom time. But it is a boom time for our brand, because we're touching these chords which matter to consumers. And it's why when I look to the future of diamonds, I think all of us here together, if we embrace these ideas, we have a really bright and strong, sustainable future going forward. I mean, De Beers is amazingly confident in diamonds. Forevermark and what we learn about consumers is one of the reasons why we're confident, but it's by long shot not the only reason. And I just want to be really clear, if there's any doubt in the room, let me be really clear. We at De Beers believe in the future of diamonds. And when I say diamonds, I mean like the real ones, those which were born billions of years ago and those which Mother Nature has uniquely made. We believe in that future. And for us, it's not just words. You could say, oh, easy for you to say that. I can assure you, there's a lot of money going into that belief on behalf of De Beers. A few examples. You know, we've just built in Canada a new mine, Gahcho Kué, operating now with our partner, Mountain Province. Cost about $1 billion. In Venetia in South Africa, we're spending $2 billion to build the underground structure, so when the open pit of Venetia, our major mine in South Africa, comes to the end of its life in a few years, it has an underground future that will take it decades into our future in terms of supply. But it costs billions of dollars now for money that we'll see a decade from now. Similarly, in Botswana, the two super mines of the world, Juwanang and Arapa, both mines have projects in place looking at the next cuts. So in a above ground mine, as you exhaust the resource, you make another cut to extend it out further, allows you to go deeper. These are costing many billions of dollars. And again, we don't see the profit for 10 years hence, money we're spending today. And there's only one reason we would do that, and it's that we have absolute confidence in the future of our product. Probably at this point, I know, I feel sometimes like Harry Potter, huh? And you know, the word that would not be mentioned in the Harry Potter movies. And to me, a little bit lab-grown, synthetic lab-grown, is a little bit like that word we don't mention. But I'm going to mention it. I'm going to talk a little bit about it. And I think my views will be clear to you on it. There's so much misinformation at the moment around this. And a lot of it, to be honest, within the trade. You know, in places like India and China, this is a trade issue today. Consumers don't talk to me about it. But we're really confusing ourselves. So let me give you a few facts. first I hear this idea that, the concept that, a lab, synthetic lab grown and a natural are chemically identical. It's not true. As Donald Trump would say, fake news, guys. It's not true. And I'll give you a simple reason why not. If it was, how can we invent a machine, the AMS, that can at speed, in fractions of a second, identify the natural from the synthetic? Because fundamentally, they have a different synthesis process. They are different. So when someone says to you they're identical, say, no, they're not, because I can identify one from the other, and I can do it quickly and easily, as long as I have the right technology. Secondly, there's this idea that they offer the consumers the same product as a diamond. It's not true either. There's more fake news. Let's just interrogate that for a minute. If you stop somebody on the street and you say to them, tell me about a diamond, what will they say? Tell me what you think when you hear the word diamond. I can tell you what they're not likely to say, unless they're a physicist and you've got the wrong person. They're not going to say, well, they're synthesized carbon. It's not likely you're going to hear that. They're going to tell you, well, they're precious, natural object of the earth. And diamonds are inherently, because they're natural, and because they're formed billions of years ago, they are inherently rare and unique things. And by definition, they are thus precious and valuable. Now, this is true also of other gemstones, rubies and emeralds. They are inherently a precious and natural thing. And you cannot make that. Synthetics, by contrast, are mass-produced with zero rarity, if one wants to, with no uniqueness. They come off the cookie cutter. You make them 25 at a time. It's not the same thing as precious. And let me tell you a story about how important it is. If you were fortunate enough to travel into the South American rainforest and you come across a very primitive culture who have never heard of marketing and advertising, never seen diamonds or other jewels, and you study them, you'll find a few things. They celebrate important moments in life in the same way that all the rest of us do. They call them rites of passage. They may be coming to manhood. It's often the wedding, the first child. They have these events in society. And for those events, they find something in their world which they consider in their world to be precious to them. Often it has something to do with nature. Often it's wood from a tree or something to do with something, but almost always a natural. But in their world, that thing is rare and that thing is precious. And they use that precious thing to mark what is a precious occasion for them. And that's the way diamonds work in the world. It's not because we've created a marketing myth that diamonds are this thing, although I quite like to take some of the credit if you want to give it to me. It's because the diamond, because it's natural, rare, is inherently a precious thing. So when people sought something to mark important moments in their life, they sought something precious to do so. And that's why only a natural diamond will sustainably be the thing that marks important events, because it is precious. And by contrast, an LGD is not, and cannot over time become that. It doesn't have the properties. The third thing, I guess, that gets me going sometimes about the LGD world is the idea that their price should be related to naturals. In any way, shape, or form, this is wrong. It's certainly misleading to the consumer, and I could argue it's even unethical. Why should you price something that you make as a discount on the price of a natural object whose price is based on its rarity value and the extraordinary cost in bringing it from the bottom of the earth to the world? That's what drives the price of diamonds. And they become, if anything, rarer and more expensive to extract from the world as we look forward into the future. And they have an enduring value because of that. The value is real, in all natural gemstones. And that's why we've seen LGD pricing drop. I don't know if you know, the prices at retail in America have dropped between 30 and 50% in a year. Wholesale, 65% down in a year. And I can tell you, it's not the bottom. The bottom is the cost at which you make them, which is substantially lower than what they're being sold at today. So as production increases, the prices are going one way, and probably fast. That's not, to me, what diamonds are. Diamonds don't do that. Diamonds are hold their value, and they are about enduring value. And when we've tested some of these ideas with consumers, one thing that really gets them to understanding is when you say to them, remember that flat screen TV you bought, and you spent like a month's income to get it, and now you go back into the store 10 years later and you can buy one five times as big for 10% of the cost. That's what technology does. And that's what's going to happen. And when they hear that, they think, crike, why am I spending all this money on something that's going to have zero value? I understand that. Where with nature's product, they understand the inherent rarity and that the money spent is something invested that the next time they go into that store, it's going to be in there sold for valuable, hopefully for more, certainly not for less. That's all part of the psyche, but we need to articulate that. And I guess what De Beers does appreciate is the need to tell that story more powerfully than we have in the past. And that's when Sachin referred to this concept of the forever initiative. That's where we're focusing more effort now. The Forever Initiative is a combination of things. Part of it is really focusing and building the competency, capability of the DPA to articulate this message about the preciousness of natural diamonds. What inherently gives them value, enduring value, and what makes them special and precious. And from September of this year, you're going to see much more geared up effort from them against this all-important task. De Beers marketing activities as well. We've asked all of our brands to look at the way in which they can incorporate into their messages this preciousness of nature's miracle and build that understanding amongst new groups of consumers of why a diamond is inherently a precious thing. When you believe that, you're not interested in buying anything else. But we need, no doubt, to increase that. We're looking at building communication platforms between people, between us and people like yourselves, probably through things like WhatsApp networks, that we can put down day after day, week after week, content which is of interest in articulating again the story and value of the natural diamond. And we're going to ask for your help as we build that in the months to come to keep those messages going out. If we send it to 500 of you and you each send it to 100 and they send it to 100, soon we talk to most people in the world. But we'll need your support in that. And even other activities like Tracer. Jim Duffy is here who runs the Tracer project. How does that fit into this? Well, I think it helps build confidence amongst consumers if they can know the source of their diamond and its journey along the pipeline. Gives them confidence that the diamond that they're buying is one that's done good on its journey and helps that concept of social purpose. Provides more support, and Forevermark wants to be an early adopter of that technology as Jim and his team build it. And the whole environmental story is an interesting one. You know, some of the things we see LGDs doing are suggesting that somehow diamonds are not good for the environment. I could argue that case pretty persuasively the other way. You know, firstly, our carbon footprint per carat is lower than synthesizing them. So I could say to the question, why do you synthesize something and create a carbon footprint when we have them naturally for less? But again, that story of protecting the environment, I think, is so powerful. We're giving back and preserving and conserving the environment. And part of that, which is interesting, is a project that we're looking at De Beers, not only to make our next mine carbon neutral, so build the mine from scratch in a way that uses renewable energies, particularly in the trucks, instead of using diesel, find other methods and then creating your own energy. We think it's possible to build a carbon neutral mine. And the next one I think will be. But beyond that, we're even looking at a project called Project Manera, where the kimberlite from which the diamonds have been released actually can store carbon. So imagine that. A diamond mine is not only carbon neutral, but actually it's carbon negative because it stores the world's carbon. Theoretically possible. We just need to make it practically so. So actually, I'm quite excited by the opportunities of telling an exciting story about the contribution that diamonds and Forevermark diamonds can make to the environment in a world where climate change is going to become ever more important. And that's all part of this concept of what we call the Forever Initiative, which I'm heading up for De Beers, and which is consuming increasing amounts of time, because I think it's particularly important. So I guess if there was any advice I would give of you as you think about your future, I'd first say, think really hard about what business you're in. I think I know what business you're in, but you need to decide that. I think you're in the business of selling precious, valuable things of enduring value and meaning to consumers. To me, that's really the role that jewelers fill in our cultural world. And I think as you think about your customers, I think you think about your customers as customers for life. And customers for life you have to treat properly now if you want them when they come back in the future, or if you want them to come back in the future, but certainly when they come back in the future to be, you know, to be happy with you. And this is, I guess, you know, sometimes I hear about some LGD players, they say, you know, there's good margin in it. I tell them, oh, why shouldn't I be in it? There's good margin. Yeah, there's good margin now. But as the prices plummet, the margins will disappear. And more importantly, some of them say to me, they don't care. You know, I talk to the guys in Silicon Valley. They say, oh, I'll be sold out by then. I don't care about the prices declining. But you do if you're a jeweler. Because when that consumer comes back in, they're going to know what you sold them last time and what value it has. And if you mistreat them now, good luck keeping them 5 years or 10 years hence. So think long term, because our business is a long term business. And De Beers, we're in it for the long term. And we need partners like you to be in it with the long term with us. So I guess lastly, what we want collectively to do is to educate together your customers about the preciousness, the uniqueness, the enduring value, the social positive contribution of natural diamonds. Because that story is really compelling when we tell it in the right way. I guess that's really where I end on this concept, that as I look around the room, this is a room full of leaders. These are the leaders of the Indian jewelry industry. De Beers, we've always thought of ourselves as a leader of the diamond industry, and we need to do what's right for diamonds as we look forward. But collectively, we have it within this room, the power to shape this market the way we want it. And the way we act will be the result that we then have, the environment we build for ourselves. It's what makes me so optimistic. You know, I know we live in a troubled world sometimes. We live in certainly a world of disruption. But through all of those issues, it's a matter of confidence, optimism, and clarity of thought and collaborative approach. And if we take it, I think we'll be really excited with the results that that we find. And again, it's why I like this theme. It's a great theme, limitless. Collectively, together, if we think in a much more ambitious way than marginal growth rates, if we think about what we can make of what we have, I think the future really is ours and that it does have no limits. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Stephen, for bringing such important perspective of De Beers and really this whole, you know, conversation that I keep hearing about what lab-grown diamonds are, what they do, what is the De Beers perspective. Thanks for bringing that clarity. But moving forward, I'll just deep dive in what's happening in our lives as Forevermark. You know, the combination, the concept of ambition is extremely important in our lives. We are very ambitious in what we do. You know, from an idea germinating in somebody's mind to delivering $1.5 billion of business year after year on your partner tables is what we've been able to achieve. Today, ForevMark is available in 32 countries. We present in 2,500 top doors in the world and colliding well with 400 jewelry companies, which are just the cream de la cream, and with the whole seriousness of building the future in this business. And you know, it's a very interesting business idea, where it's a combination of us at De Beers, the manufacturers and retailers bringing on what we do best. Deep in diving on what we are doing in India, from the Indian office, we run the Indian, of course, the geography of India. We also run the Middle East market. We run the newly opened markets of Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal. We're also launching Sri Lanka and Bhutan very soon. And we said Bhutan, a lot of people wanted to just go there and explore the market more than actually, you know, building the market. Deep diving on what India has been able to deliver. You know, we have, over the last 2016 to 19, has been one of the most important growth phases for us. Ironically, that was at a time when the trade and the business environment wasn't the most conducive. And if I were to say, what's that one thing that's worked, and what is that one thing that's led to that growth, is this enduring partnership we had with you. You know, we've tried with you, we've failed, we've succeeded, we've done small things, we've tried to do bigger things, and it's that one thing that succeeded, is the spirit of partnership. And that leads us to what we're aiming to do in 2019. We intend to do about 275,000 diamonds with 75,000 carats done in our market. And I'm 100% certain that we don't even need a 31st December for this. This will be done by Diwali. And that's all the partnership that we've done together. Moving forth, you know, I also at times get asked this question, why ForevMark? Although I do get asked less and less. You know, at times I do get discussed about, is it really adding value? And more I see the actual results on the floor, so that's clear. But what Stephen was talking about as to what ForevMark brings in is this whole journey right from the mind to the finger, any part of it that you have to be confident, telling your consumer the right stories, that's all one part. But what we are really bringing in is making your business future-proof and ready for the new age consumer, and not just a traditional offering. And I'll encourage at the back that you see all the elements we've created, which are really future-proofing our business for and getting you ready for the new age consumer. But if I were to say, what are the three key points? You know, we say ForevMark diamonds are 100% guarantee that they're natural, they're the way Mother Earth gave it to them. So that's one of the very important aspects. Second is about this whole concept that Stephen touched about was beyond the four C's. It's about the beauty of the diamond. Pretty much everybody sitting in this room understands 4 C's is not good enough, and a paper is not good enough. You know, to identify the beauty of the diamond, you have to go beyond. Here is an opportunity to offer a consumer, which is not something that's available to the next door neighbor jeweler. It's something different. And lastly, it's the partnership with the De Beers Group. We are your partner to push you to do better. We are your partner to bring out processes in the business that help us a future alignment. To give you one example, all our siteholder partners operate on best practice principles. There's a lot of merit they get around the financial world. Moving forth, it'll be a lot of merit with the consumer world to do the right storytelling. And I'd like to show you a short video which encapsulates really the essence of a ForevMark diamond. Can I please have the video?
Deep within the earth, formed over 3 billion years ago, rare, natural, rough diamonds. This is where ForevMark starts. No hidden alterations or treatments. Crafted by the world's finest diamondaires. Rigorously examined and hand-selected. Less than 1% of the world's diamonds are eligible for the ForevMark inscription. ForevMark diamonds, a precious gift of nature. ForevMark, a diamond is forever.
Have a choice to offer a consumer something that's by far the best, by far the most beautiful, and the guarantee of De Beers. Moving forth, what's happening on retail? We at De Beers strongly believe in the physicality of your business. You know, when we started the brand with about 1 meter, 2 meter spaces in your store. Today, my heart swells with pride when I look at what we've been able to achieve along with you. Today, we have 150 shop-in-shops across our network here. And that is a dedicated space of 70,000 square feet that you all have dedicated on the brand. And what it really does is brings in the right focus, the right environment, the right, you know, attitude to sell diamonds. Consumers are looking up to brands. The aspirations are met. Very interestingly, last year, you know, our stock-to-earn ratio across the cell was 2.18 times. Compare that to what it is in generic. But here we have a partner, you know, like us, which is pushing you and getting you the focus to sell diamonds in the right manner. That's what we were able to achieve. We also have opened some of our retail stores. The first that we started with CKC in Bangalore. Here again, a new start that we did in Bangalore. These, you know, while your stores are catering to a much wider consumer, the ForeverMark store is focused to catering to a more niche millennial consumer offer. And here we see more and more consumers who are coming to, you know, have a chat, just understand the story of diamonds, look at products that aren't so serious. Impulse is very high. We have 5 such stores today, and we are in the process that by the end of this year, we'll have 10 such stores along with our jewelry partners. I'll encourage all of you to engage with our retail team to get more details as to how we are building a future on providing a retail environment amongst us. We don't rest on our laurels. We're also working on what we call the next gen retail. We believe this will revolutionize the way storytelling in our industry happens, how diamonds will get engaged with the new age consumer. We have on display the virtual reality of the store. It's almost up and ready. We intend to launch this middle of next year, engage in it, but see the future on how we are creating science, technology with underpaid luxury. So I encourage all of you to engage in this area as well. Now, at times I really get asked a question as to what do we sell in ForeverMark? What is the merchandise? You know, at times people ask me that if I add ForeverMark, you know, what's the additional investment I got to do in diamonds? And I want to make it clear that we play an ingredient role. We play a role of the ingredient of what you're offering in your shape and form to a consumer. At times people say that, you know, if it's additional investment or not. And my point is that if your investment in diamonds is 1,000 carats, by adding ForeverMark, it remains 1,000 carats. We only play with the share of voice of what we do in it. And amongst the products, there are a variety of things that we offer. First of them is our big ideas. These are designs that are patented by us at De Beers, and we offer them based on solving a unique problem of a consumer or an emotional need of a consumer. They're consistent across the globe. So we have had very successful ones like Encordia, Melamore, recent ones like Tribute, which is the stackable rings that all of you saw great success on. We do a lot of things that we call are the FMJ collections. These are collections that we work with you based on a consumer brief you give us. And we work with our Milan team who designs and collaborates with you to create collections that matter to you and are unique to you. We also play a lot of worth in what we call classics. And here it's not about design, it's about the ingredient role. And this for us is the most phenomenal growth that we've seen over the last few years. And why have we seen that? A consumer who's buying a bangle and she's looking at buying, you know, a pair of bangles that has 80 diamonds. Every single diamond of the 80 diamonds comes with the guarantee of De Beers, of ForeverMark, of integrity, of the whole conviction that they are what they are. Every diamond comes with an inscription card. So that really opened up this whole category of the classics. We also are working on what we call the trend collections. And this is a whole study and initiative we did over the last few years. We've seen that consumers who walk into your store look up to you as trendsetters. You know, while your wider creations are about addressing the core needs, but we have to keep in mind what are the trends happening in the world. And our team in Milan studies these trends not just in jewelry business, but in the world at large. They come out with something called the trend book, and these designs, as not just simple designs, but catering as collections and real solutions to your floor, can be available. And you'll be able to see all of these across all our manufacturer partners. I'd like to show a video of the trends for 2019. Can I please have the video? And this, what you're seeing here, are not just designs that we created in isolation. They're based on consumer research, comes with all collaterals that you'll need to translate a design story at the floor. And all of this is available with the tireless work that all our partners have done. And we also create what we call partner collections. All our manufacturer partners work with us on creating some ideas, concepts, caratage, price points, and we put our entire effort together to create something that can work at your floors. And I'd like to share one example of what really worked in the last year. Amongst the variety of things that we worked, one of the things that really worked was an inspiration that one of our partners took from the whole tribute collection of stackables, but he created his own version, and we helped him create a very interesting collateral, and that's what I'm going to share. It's something that gained a lot of traction on social media. Again, a language that today's consumers are willing to listen to. Can I please have the video of the Rack and Stack? Aspects. I mean, it's a great collection, but like this, we have lots more. But when you engage, we create the right content which could be ready for you to engage with your consumers. And that's the beauty about this whole effort. Now, we are very much interested in that the consumers at your store get the right experience, read the right storytelling of what our industry is all about. We spend a whole amount of effort with your stores to train your sales ambassadors who all work with us. You know, all our sales teams really starts our day at your stores. Last year, we trained 9,000 of your sales ambassadors. I mean, that's a whooping number, and it's, different kinds of trainings we did, got them the energy and the content of how they can do current storytelling. And that number was really trained on a variety of eras. And we do it more and more on a daily basis. We have a monthly newsletter, In the Loop. We this time came out with the 54th edition. It's growing its popularity day on day. Every month we take a theme, we talk to your sales ambassadors with this, and something that, has created a very interesting open channel with our sales ambassadors. And over here, we also recognize what we call our shining stars. And these are people who've done extremely well for us over the year. Today, we have a few of our shining stars sitting amongst us. These are people who made us proud. They've translated the story of diamonds the way we all think it should be. It was not about a calculator and a discount. They were able to share this whole story of Forevermark and why diamonds in a beautiful manner. I'd like to acknowledge them. If they can please stand up as their names get announced.
These names are in no particular order. Please stand as I call the name. Dharun Joshi. Ramanasai B. Ravichandran. Narendra Kumar. Mohammed Rizwan Ullah. Manikandan. Ajit Kumar. Pramod V. Robin Jose. Yogesh Doshi. Amit Kumar.
Where is everybody?
Okay. Karamjeet Kaur. Neeraj Shukla. Shatabdi Majumdar. Sujata Manna. Disha Jubalia. Vaishali Mahadik. Madhumati De. Prema BG. And Naveen Kumar.
Guys, join me giving a big round of applause to these people. These are true rock stars who've done a great job in our industry. And these are people who need to be acknowledged. Kindly have your seats. Thank you. We are also launching two very interesting further steps on training your people. We're launching our e-learning platform, and I encourage all of you to get in the FM zone where it's online learning. It's a certificate-based learning that you can subscribe to for your people and something that is getting offered to ensure that all your people are on top of the game. We're also launching something called MLM, that's the mid-level manager program, where we're engaging with the top universities in India, taking them to school, sharpening their skills so they can nurture, be nurtured by your organizations to be leaders for tomorrow. One of the programs, again, amongst the training that we feel very proud is a project Gallup that we started last year. We took all you limitless leaders back to school, got you to training, you know, through best trainers of the world and the best universities. Our first step was where we took our partners to Cambridge. That was the first step we took. This year was a very unique one, where we went to Shanghai, which I believe is the retail capital of the world. And we were able to construct a program along with London School of Economics based on leadership. And we address issues like building culture in your organizations, about how succession planning can happen, how to deal with disruption, and variety of other sub-subjects. I'd like to show you a glimpse of that 3-day, which I'm sure I thoroughly enjoyed, and I'm sure the LSE alumni sitting here would have thoroughly enjoyed. Can I please have the video? As a partner, that's what we're bringing on the table to really, you know, nurture the true limitless leadership in this room. Now, let's talk about what we did in marketing. I mean, 2012, we used to do 2 campaigns. Today, we transformed to do a 365-day, always-on campaign. And it's not about just the mega campaigns that we deliver. That, of course, happens. But very innovative ideas on floor, on working with the best minds in the world. And we created our mega campaign last year, which was around the half carat. And, you know, it was an area, it was a kind of an area which did not exist as a category. We nurtured it. We had a mega campaign last year on it. To share with you, we sold 15,500 diamonds that were between 40 points to 70 points that were transacted on your floors with this campaign. And, you know, a variety of other such. We also do a campaign of close setting, which we did particularly for South Market. We did 40 co-op campaigns this year with all of you. And these are campaigns created not just on design alone, but on needs that you had on the floor, and how we can bring in our best lines and how we can bring in with it these co-op campaigns. Marketing is slightly wider for us. You know, events and PR at the core. We always, you know, when we internally we're talking about, we say whether we are really a, you know, ForevMark company or we should rename it as a ForevMark events company. We did 100 events last year. 100 events at your floors. And when we do events, you know, when we're launching our brand, and when I showed you initially in 60 markets, we are very clear that our brand is not, if we do a great thing in Bombay City, a consumer in Jamshedpur has pretty much nothing to do with it. If we have to succeed in your market, we do things with you in your physical geography. And these all events were pretty much all kinds. At the heart of it, you know, there's also a lot of work we do on the PR side. We had over 2 billion impressions on PR this time, but heart of it is you as a partner. We've had red carpet products that go out. You know, which is, red carpet has actually arguably become one of the most important events of our annual calendar. The Golden Globe, BAFTAs, Oscar Awards, all these are cinematic ceremonies that have captivated the global audience. But year after year, all you partners have pushed the boundaries of creativity and the world has taken notice. This year itself, 24 of our jewelry partners had their jewelry was adorned at these platforms. What this does is really what true partnership brings in. It's a platform we build in, we get these products back with a lot of PR, a lot of asset creation, and really get you to excel to what you're capable of. The whole world, as Stephen was referring to, is moving towards digital. And right now, we work very closely with the most creative minds in Instagram, at Google, at YouTube, and there's some creative stuff that we got out with. Today, our social media community is about 6 lakhs. We have about 16 lakh people who visited our website last year, and that's month on month who spent quality time at our website. We had 18 million views on YouTube. That's full views that people saw on YouTube for all our creatives. We're launching this Live Love, which is already there. And you know, the whole modern context, as even Stephen referred to, is not a one-way street, that you're a brand and you throw the content. It is also engaging consumers to what they can bring on the table. So Live Love is one such initiative, which is a two-way street. And it's amazing the kind of content people are out there sharing with us. We do lots and lots of innovation. I recently learned a new terminology that says thumbs press. So basically the whole thing on mobile is, what is that creative where your thumb starts shaking and you say, stop. And that's the whole initiative they've done on innovative ads. And lots of success we've taken on co-op areas around it. One of the best campaigns we did was on a faith collection that we did with AS Motiwala, where we got great traction on mobile, on the whole effort of mobile. And the result is that the awards that we got over the last 1 year is not just on the jewelry category, it's on the whole consumer business. My urge to all of you is that engage with the marketing team, see how these ideas can become reality in your worlds and your initiatives. We're also, interestingly, launching today what we call the WhatsApp bot. You know, WhatsApp today is the third largest social media platform in the world where people can engage. This is over 200 million people are there. In 2018, WhatsApp launched their business area where they realized that consumers are growingly wanting to communicate with brands and wanting to communicate with businesses the way they talk to family. We're launching this today for B2B, so you can engage with us as a brand. And I urge all of you to open your phones and please scan the code up there and we can have the instructions from your side.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, please hold your phones and turn on your cameras. For Android users, please open your Google Lens and scan the QR code. For those with Samsung, kindly open the QR code scanners and do the same. Thank you.
And what you'll see is the way a brand can engage with consumers on a WhatsApp, which is, you know, in Indian perspective, is the most interesting, the most commonly used. So something that we launched today. So go ahead and, you know, WhatsApp, interact with the brand, and it's all computerized. So it's all sort of a robotic way by which we're engaging now. Now, every year while we're building the future, we base it on a bit of science and a bit of research of what we've seen. This year, we've completed our most important research of consumers across the country. We call it the Diamond Purchasers Insight. This is a very detailed insight study that we did over 41 cities, over 16,500 consumers. And what we really found are elements of what are the new attitudes that consumers are getting impacted on. What are the designs? What are the contents? What is really happening on the floor to make us future ready or to be ready for the future? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a short video. While this is a very detailed study, and our team, particularly Diana, who's behind this, is right here with us. I encourage you to talk to her in depth. But I'll show you a study which picks up some of the key elements of where the consumer is headed to. Can I please have the video?
The D. Beers Group conducted the single largest survey on the Indian diamond consumer. We'd like to present the findings to you today. These findings are based on interviews with 16,000 consumers from 41 cities across India. We used a detailed questionnaire as well as face-to-face interviews to gain these insights. And this is what we learned. This study brings a great news. The diamond market in India is still highly underpenetrated, indicating a huge opportunity for growth in this industry. Considering money not being a constraint, the intention to purchase fine jewelry is the highest amongst all luxury goods. However, this overall intent is weakening. A woman's attitude towards diamond jewelry was found to be more about individual image and positive emotions rather than eternal love. 61% of the respondents purchased for self and not for any special occasion. When it comes to ownership of diamond jewelry, the average number of pieces is fairly consistent across the four different types of jewelry. Now they purchase diamonds at will, irrespective of seasons. And here's where they buy their diamonds from. Diamond certification is very important to them. As India aims to become a $5 trillion economy by 2024, the diamond industry is bound to grow. This study was brought to you by Forever Mark and D. Beers Group. We'd love to engage with you to discuss more insights.
So I encourage all of you to engage with our team, get more insights of what you might want to explore in your markets, because that's what's happening on ground. But four key inputs that I would like to pick up from this. First and the foremost was the penetration of diamonds in India. You know, what an opportunity. We're at 10%. What a phenomenal one. Let's sort of deep dive into this. There's a whole sense that we come out on casualization that reflects the life that women are leading in India. You know, they're dropping the kids to school, they're going running their offices. All of that is happening quite seamlessly, and casualization is coming in. Are we ready with the right solutions for those casual occasions for the consumers? Non-bridal, my friends, is 58% of the market. It's amazing. And at times, we get really over-obsessed that all the reselling in the diamond business is bridal. That's a rain check on how the future should be. Very importantly, I've referred to that we need to move from becoming great jewelers to becoming great retailers. Retail is a 12-month business. Diamonds is the only business that's almost, you know, similar across the entire calendar. We need to find new ways and reasons why consumers need to come in, find new occasions for them to celebrate. But it's very interesting. And last but not the least is this whole concept of self-worth and self-consumption. Last year, we talked about womenomics, and the biggest growth area for us that we believe in the Indian circuit will be consumers and women buying for themselves and the whole emergence of the women economy. And that's something that's growing dramatically. Align your strategies, align your products and the whole scope so that this is really in line with what the need of the market is. And please, I encourage you to have a deep discussion with us on your requirements on this. We launched this whole campaign of ours at end of 2017, beginning of 2018 on credentials. And that was really targeted to answer the whole anxiety that consumers have around buying diamonds. We are relaunching our campaign this time, which is actually our biggest campaign on credentials. It's a 360-degree campaign. I'm sure the biggest attempt we've done to stir consumer demand and solve this anxiety in consumers' mind around diamond, where they should buy, where should they should go to, and what is the content they should buy on. I'll show you a video that gives you how this whole power of this campaign is going to be alive. This campaign kicks off in August and goes up almost till December. Can I please have the video?
Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
They say diamonds are a girl's best friend.
But how do you distinguish the authenticity and true value of these beautiful stones? Are they genuine and trustworthy? The buyer's concern on quality. Am I paying the right price for the right quality? The never-ending doubts on the four C's of the precious stone. Anxious questions on the resale value of the purchased diamond. Anxiety on certification. Am I sure of getting an authentic certificate? Forever Mark recognized these concerns and created the credentials campaign for the consumers, giving them an assurance of the quality, beauty, and authenticity of each stone. This straightforward and rational line of communication really made an impact on consumers, and here is what they are saying about us. The information shared about the authenticity is very helpful for me to select diamonds. Completely pure diamonds and the world's best diamond. It is a certified diamond and more reliable, and the diamonds are appealing and more fashionable. They found that Forever Mark was different from the rest, and we were being recognized as diamond experts. A brand with individually selected diamonds, with distinctive jewelry designs, with the best quality diamonds. We always had positive perceptions. But post the credentials campaign, the associations became stronger and reassuring. Forever Mark has taken a strong step towards the right direction with high expertise, quality and prestige, all key to premium associations. The campaign was a major success across platforms, also winning an Effie's Award for its effectiveness. The success of the credentials campaign has made us invest in it once more. This time, the campaign will be bigger, better, with increased visibility and reach, with an emphasis on winning over consumers who are anxious buyers. This year, we will increase the reach of the campaign and cover the entire country across all regions in a variety of languages with an always-on strategy peaking from the months of August to December. We will cover every touch point. Campaign 2.0 will instill in buyers a sense of assurance, confidence, and peace of mind while making this precious purchase. We will build their trust and belief in Forever Mark and aim to be recognized the foremost diamond experts.
So again, that's not really the real campaign. That's the power of what we're investing in, and you see the impact on your floor. Engage with us, block your rates, see how we can work together on this campaign, because this will really drive the consumer into your stores. Stephen touched about this whole effort that we did on elephant translocation. And you know, this is while we're in the whole purpose of saying what is our purpose, I wanted to share this one example with you. He talked about, you know, there was a unique problem in South Africa. The problem was that there are more elephants than less. So when you have more elephants to maintain the ecology, you cull the elephants, which is certainly not the right thing to do. And we chose to take the more difficult path of translocating over 200 such elephants from South Africa to Mozambique. And I'll show you a video. And that's something that we feel proud about at De Beers. And it's not just about us being feeling proud about it. It's a story that we can translate at the consumer end to make really feel proud as to what natural diamonds do to the world. Can I please have the video of the elephant translocation? A very important initiative, but a very, you know, something to feel proud of as an industry. Stephen also talked about Tracer, and Tracer is our initiative at Blockchain Technology. The Internet of Value platform aims to establish a baseline trust within the diamond industry by ensuring provenance and traceability and authenticity. Tracer is built by the industry, for the industry, which means everything remains within the business. And creating a data culture and enabling all of us to talk that one language. And today, the fact is that it brings a lot of credibility to the outside world, but moving forth when this is active, it'll create a lot of credibility in the storytelling and the confidence that we'll bring in. And we have amongst us Mr. Jim Duffy, who's heading this whole project. Encourage all of you to interact with him and see how this will really shape up the future of what we're bringing in. Now the fun part. At the backside, you have the what we call is the most important area that we created as a Foramark zone. We have about 17 new insights that we brought out, a lot of innovations there. I urge all of you to spend time there. When we say that we're going to be driving this whole change in retail, these are the elements that will impact. There's some of them, but make a sense of it, get in detail of it. I'll highlight a few of them. We have a virtual reality whole setup, which will define how the next gen retail is all about. You know, spend some time there. We also have all the Foramark trend zones, so all the displays that we're bringing in. Behind me, this is going to go up. We have a whole VM suite here. So all the different elements of how visual merchandising can happen, every occasion, including Diwali, including Pujo, including South festivals, what are the regional windows we created for consumers? They're all right behind us. It's going to go up, and we can experience that. We also set up what we call a De Beers ecosystem. You know, it's going back when kids used to create the arts and craft. It's in that fashion, but a very beautiful way of showing our entire journey and lots of other things there. So I encourage you to please spend time there and define all of this, how this can come into your stores. And I got to ask a question from you, sir, about all these lovely things that you should show, would they go in retail? The answer is yes. So please work with us, discuss with us how they can be a part of your retail journey and your retail stores. We're also launching one of our most aggressive way to, in a way, thank everybody here. It's a very aggressive incentive scheme that we're launching today. This is for all the buying you'll do from today till day after tomorrow, in a way to thank all of you to be here and you graced our occasion. The incentive we're launching, all the investments are going to go into building consumer demand at your floors in different sort of arrangements that we can do. There are really three categories on this. For all buying that you'll do from today, for 30 carats to 99 carats, we're investing 6,000 rupees per carat. For 100 to 499, it's 7,500 rupees a carat. 500 plus carats, it's 9,000 rupees a carat. But we believe that we are ready. We want you to get the product on the floor. The product is here. All our partners have worked very hard. Get the ball rolling and make the most of it. It's something that, as I said, is an acknowledgement that all of you are here with us. We also believe a lot in knowledge series. For all of us who've been here in the previous forums, every year we get an outside perspective of people who sort of give a perspective from outside the business into what we are doing. Tomorrow, we have the knowledge series session that begins sharp at 9:30. We have three eminent speakers. The first, I'll start from the other side. We have Costantino, who's our own team member. But we believe internally that he's a deep thinker and almost a futurist. And he's going to talk about retail. And we're looking forward to your session, Costa. We have amongst us Mr. Abhinay Chaudhary. He's the co-founder of Big Basket. You know, an attempt he'd made of becoming the biggest grocery seller in our country. And that's not a small aim. And he's talking about trust. When you're buying an egg or you're buying a bread or a potato, a consumer is reflecting to trust. And what is that perspective? So when we're selling diamonds, it's a very changing phase, but it'll be a very interesting one. And we have Sushmita Mohanty, which actually is the closest to what our theme is, to be limitless. She's a person who started her career with NASA in 91. Today, she owns three companies, three satellite companies, and space design companies in three different continents. While she was talking to me, she said that what the way humankind used to think about air travel 100 years ago is the way we're currently thinking about space travel. She believes in a few years, you might just take a holiday to Ooty or to Missouri, or you say, let me go to space. And that's the reality. It's a very interesting perspective she's bringing in. She's been to space a few times, and she's going to get her own real captured content of how Earth looked from space. So we'll have her as well. So please be here sharp at 9:30. And let's engage and learn from all these inspiring people. I can't thank enough our manufacturer partners. From day one when we started our business, they are people who stood behind us. Every step of growth we've taken is with them. And all the creations you see is a diligent hard work that's happened over a lot of months. So I urge you to absorb these, see all the creations, you know, and see what fits into your consumer need. So please, I encourage you to make rounds to every single of a partner who's done that work here. And now towards the end, you know, I just wanted to highlight this bit. You know, the fact is that, you know, we are in the 8th year of ForeverMark in India. I had the great chance to approach all of you to start ForeverMark when we did. You know, at those times, we weren't too sure what you were offering. At times, you weren't too sure what you're betting on. Today, we're getting more clearer. But I can only guarantee you that all the faces you see up there on pictures, everybody at De Beers is right behind you to make your business grow. We want to be the real partners. We want you to push us. We want you to brainstorm with us, find some solutions. But let's get tracking, because we have only one mode, and that is to grow your diamond business. I urge you all, you would have seen an envelope on your seats. I urge you all to pick that envelope up. Write your being limitless. What are you going to do to be limitless? What is it that you've never tried and you're going to do it now? Define your future. Stick it close to your heart, could be on your pocket, your most important table, but revisit it every day. That's something that once you shape it up, we believe you'll make it happen. And I urge you all to make the most of it. You know, our real vision of life really is that a few years from now, when somebody's writing a history book on your organization, that the first two chapters, and I'll tell you what you think it should be. The second chapter should be that the phase of 2019 to 24 was the most phenomenal phase I've witnessed in my entire career. And you'll have a chapter on that. But the first chapter will be that you had ForeverMark as a partner who pushed you to make it happen. So my dear friends, I wish you good luck, wish you all the best, and let's rock this season. And before we move out, all that you've heard from us in the last 90 minutes, I want to just recap it quickly in the next 90 seconds. So please hold your breath. My dear friends, from the bottom of my heart and on behalf of everybody at De Beers, a big thank you for all of you to be here. Please, let's rock the season. Let's make the most. And thank you again. Make the most in the next few days. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sachin. That was very informative and truly inspiring for all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, I guarantee the next few days are going to be exhilarating and enriching for all of you. We encourage all of you to fill in those limitless cards. And remember, limitations only exist for those who set them. Explore your potential, innovate, and embrace the unconventional. This forum, go beyond your boundary and be limitless. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we are all fans of cricket, so we will be streaming the live semi-finals of India-New Zealand right away. Don't worry, it'll start in about 5 minutes from now.